So on behalf of all the participants who are here and who are going to see this program also, I welcome Anand Tirthan for this program. It will be a lovely program which is not seen otherwise before. Sanjay ji, you are from Bikaner. Now this whole program will be in English only. So it depends, all your questions you can ask Sanand ji. He will be able to give a good explanation. He has been conducting so many programs in English particularly. So it will be an enjoyable one. So those who want to ask question, kindly raise the hands, raise option, so that we can start the questioning. You need not wait for the other person to start ask the question. Oh, that is great. So nice, Sanjay Srivastav. Just tell a word about your place also, Bikaner. Okay, because many of us might not visited that place, very near to Pakistan and all this. Okay, I am unmuting you.
Okay. So I would like to ask a question. When I read Ayya's teaching, he keeps on emphasizing that this I consciousness also comes and goes, and with each experience, I consciousness it comes and goes, just like a smoke from incense, something like that. So the point is that in that case, how is it possible for anyone to plan for any long term? Suppose today I plan that I will file my tax returns in July. If this I consciousness which has planned now, it also goes away, then how is it possible after 3 months or 2 months that I am able to execute that plan? In that case, there should not be any possibility of any long-term plan.
Okay. Is the question over?
Yep.
Okay. Fine. So I think, so you're talking about, you must have heard this from one of the videos or books, right? So I guess you're talking, taking it from there, I guess. Okay. So I think he must have clearly differentiated in the book itself that there is a psychological I identity and the physical identity, which is related to our external world activities. So all this is applicable. This, you know, momentary I and which gets lost every moment along with the thought is for the psychological identity or the psychological I. So it is only for that. It is not about the physical activities related I. So there, as you rightly said, you know, you have to plan your housing, your, you know, taxation and salary and you know, all your living life related activities. So you have to plan. So that is required for your physical activities. So it is only with respect to your psychological activities, there is no such identity and it is all momentary. So that's what he is trying to explain here. So have you got that?
Okay, so that is, I would say that another concept, because I had not read about this physical I thing earlier. So maybe I missed it.
Yeah.
Another thing that keeps nagging on me is that Ayya says that you don't have any responsibility in the psychological world. You don't have to set right your psychological state. That is all right, fine. But the thing is that he also says that you have to work in the physical, in the externals. So you have to continue working. The thing is that because the external situations are not to my liking, that is why there is a dissatisfaction in my psychological state. And it is because of that dissatisfaction that dissatisfaction itself goads me into the action. So set external things all right. If I just ignore my psychological state, then there is no motivation for me to arrange the external situations also, because the external situations, when they are not to my liking, then correspondingly there is some dissatisfaction, there is some resentment, some frustration. And in order to take care of that frustration, then I start working on the external state. So if I don't give any importance to my psychological state, then there is no point for me to tackle external situations.
Yeah. Okay. Yes, that is correct. So if you want to keep the motivation based on your likes and dislikes, you know, then it will be, you will only work on things which you like, and you will not work on things you don't like, you know, even if it is part of your duty, right? So that's the whole idea. So then you will not be able to perform your duties correctly. So for doing your external activities, rather than depending on your desires or liking, it is always better to go with what is right, what is required in this particular situation. Is there anything that I need to do in this situation, or is it better to be quiet and step back? So what is required for that situation is more important than what I like to do, right? Of course, if it's a trivial matter, you can always, you know, compromise and do what you want. But if it's really a situation where it requires some decision making, some important situation, critical situation, then you have to, that is when it helps, where you can ignore your likes and dislikes, and you can simply do whatever is required in that situation. So this is what is called as, I think, you must have read Gita, right? Karma Yoga is what is this, right? Beyond your likes and dislikes, you just do your duty, what is required. So that's how it helps.
Yeah, that is more like Nishkam Karma Yoga, but and it is all right. But that kind of takes out passion from your work. You are not passionate about your work, doing as a duty, as a societal order or something like that, just to maintain the social order. It is not something you are passionate about, unless your psychological frame of mind is also taken care of. You get my point?
Yeah, okay. So your question is, if I'm not passionate, you know, if I'm not passionately doing the work, you're feeling uncomfortable with that, right?
Yeah.
So that's the problem. If you see the root of this, if you understand, try to understand the root of your question. So again, this is a like and dislike, right? So you have assumed when basically from the childhood, all this has got into our memory and, you know, kind of our habit or nature, I would say, is that you have to do work passionately. This is something that we have sort of assumed that this is how it should be. So that is why you are feeling uncomfortable. So what I'm saying is, so it is not about whether you are feeling, whether you are liking or disliking. It is only the duty or the task that is required at that moment is more important. Even if you do not have that passion, so that's not a problem. There is nothing wrong about not doing something passionately. Right? And you cannot create passion. Only if you really like the task, then obviously passion will follow you, or passion, you know, will be there. Otherwise, you will obviously dislike. Suppose if I don't like working in my office, obviously I'll not be comfortable working, right? So that will be there. It's not about passion. It's about what is the task activity required at that point of time. That is more important.
Okay. And one more thing, I would request some more clarity about. He keeps on saying that you don't take any responsibility for your psychological state. So, he says that you don't take any responsibility for your psychological state. So what does it exactly mean in practice? It means I just ignore my psychological states, whatever emotions or thoughts come, I just ignore them, or does it mean anything else? Some clarity is required.
Is it better now, Babula?
I can hear it. I'm not sure.
If... You can hear me, right? So Babula, sir. Okay, sir, you are on mute, Babula, sir.
Yeah, okay, now I have opened. See, the thing is you are releasing the mic a little. Okay, so you hold it closer so that it will be audible better.
Okay, is it better?
Yeah, it is better. Okay, I'll open one more person to say that it is better.
Okay, okay.
Mr. Lakshmi, I'm opening you, just give the feedback.
Yeah. Okay. Yes, Muthulakshmi.
ஆனந்த் நீங்க அவர் சொல்ற மாதிரி அந்த மைக்க வந்து கொஞ்சம் வாய் பக்கத்திலேயே வச்சுட்டு பேசினா பெட்டரா இருக்கு. ரொம்ப கீழே அப்படி போயிடுச்சுன்னா இதுவா இருக்கு. ஹேண்ட்ஸ் ஃப்ரீயா பேசணும், ஹேண்ட்ஸ் இதுவா யூஸ் பண்ணணும்னா நீங்க அப்படி பண்ணிக்கலாம், இல்லைன்னா இது ஹோல்ட் பண்ணிட்டே இருக்கணும் காஷியஸா.
So that's fine. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you. Yeah. Okay. So your question was about ignoring your mind and how to ignore, is it?
Yeah.
Okay.
What
so,
does it mean?
Okay, so the when we say ignore here, so the point is ignorance, this ignoring your mind should not be another action based on your likes and dislikes. So what we have to understand is this ignorance or ignoring your mind is an outcome of the understanding that we get from this whole about this whole psychological system. So what is the understanding that we have from this psychological this concept of pravagam, which gives us that this whole psychological system, which is called this mind, wherein our thoughts, emotions, feelings, all these things flow. So they all flow, come up on their own and die down on their own. They subside on their own. We don't have any role to play, right? See, if there is a problem only, then you have to resolve, right? If there is no problem, is there any need to resolve? There is no need to resolve, right? So what we are saying is, as it is just purely scientific, it is not, there is no any mystical concept or any spiritual theory which we are talking about. It is purely scientific. If you throw a ball up, the ball is supposed to come down to the earth, right? So similarly, any thought or emotions or feeling which arises in our mind, it is bound to subside. And it is actually speaking, technically speaking, it actually resides only for a fraction of a second. Fraction of a second in our mind. It is only because we try to deal with those thoughts and emotions, it actually continues. Every moment it is like, you know, you are pumping the air, you are pumping the energy to those emotions and thoughts. Every moment we are tirelessly doing that. So that's why it's continuing. If you just stop doing this, giving this energy, pumping this energy to your thoughts and emotions by simply ignoring them and allowing it to flow as is, right? Only by the means of the understanding this whole system, then you will be able to ignore. So ignorance should not be another action based on your decision that, you know, today I decide, okay, from now onwards, I'm going to ignore my mind. That will not work. So it has to be based on your understanding. So have I clarified?
Okay. Yeah, okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Sanjay ji, you got any more questions?
Not now.
Okay. As the program goes, you can still ask that question. It is going to be fully in English, so you can enjoy that. But you did not tell anything about Bikaner. Okay? Bikaner, how near it is to Pakistan?
Nearest border is about 100 kilometers.
100 kilometers. Good. What is Bikaner known for?
Bikaner is known for Gullah and maybe some sand dunes and small forts. Bikaner is a small city. It is a small town, about 6-7 lakh people, and it is in the middle of a desert. So, but it is mainly entrepreneurial classes there. A lot of people are their own industry, something like that.
So we'll know Bikaner because of Sanjay Srivastava. Okay, great it is. It's a good occasion. So I am meeting you now. You can come back again. You can ask the question to Chananji. And you can have a discussion with him as Sanjay had it. Okay, we can have your opinion. you can ask for clarification. This is the right occasion, good occasion. Now, those who want to do, kindly raise their hands raise option so that we can unmute you. This program is only in English. Again, I will unmute. Okay, any answers, questions has to be in English. If somebody by mistake or unavoidably they ask the question in different language, say Tamil. Okay, I request Anandji to translate it in English, both question and answer. Okay,
yeah.
So I'm unmuting to Sanjay Ji. Sanjay Ji, you can ask.
Yeah, okay, since no one is asking, so I thought that I will ask another question. I come from, I can say that I have tried different teachings and recently for quite some time Vedanta teachings also. And in Vedanta, you always say that this knowledge should always come from a Guru Shishya Parampara, and they trace it right up to Bhagwan Shankara. So, from that perspective, where does this Ayyas teaching fit in?
So, I just want to understand your question clearly. So, you are saying it has to be this, all the spiritual knowledge has to be gained from a Guru-Sishya relationship.
That is what Vedanta teachings say. And okay. Because I have some background in Vedanta, so I thought that I would ask this, that whether it fits into that or not, because in Vedanta it is Guru Shishya Parampara is given a lot of importance, though I'm not really sure it's required or not, but they give this importance and ultimately they try to trace it to Shankara himself.
Yeah, so I believe it is definitely required, because so even here I think even in our concept, so it definitely there is a Guru Shishya relationship which exists, right? Like Ayya gives his teaching and gives the understanding, and you can go through and you can ask your questions, and people like us, a lot of us also, you know, do the same thing. So Guru need not be, Guru can be even a colleague, or you know, need not be, you know, somebody elderly figure or something like that. It can be a colleague also who has understood the concept, so who can explain and clarify your questions, right? So that's exactly is happening. So which I believe it is required definitely, because sometimes if you get stuck, you may not know how to proceed. So people who have already gone through that path should be able to help you in that context.
Now, my question was actually a bit different. Because Vedantic tradition, it is imperative that you trace your parampara right up to Shankara. Otherwise, it is not considered authentic, because it is, they say that one or two people may be inspired people, and they deny directly also that they do not deny. But the thing is that ultimately, Upanishads, they are kind of record of, you can say, tradition of means a record of consistent tradition of people, and every understanding has to be tested on the anvil of Upanishad, because one or two people might be inspired, but they may not they may be inspired and they may also have the correct knowledge themselves, but in transmission that knowledge may get distorted. So ultimately it is necessary that all this knowledge has to be tested on the anvils of Upanishad, because they are not inspiration of one person. They are actually a record of so many inspired people. So ultimately when you test it on that, then you are not going to go astray. But if you depend on the inspired teachings of one individual who does not trace his lineage in that tradition, then there is a possibility that even if that person is realized, there may be some communication gap. Okay. Am I clear?
Yeah. Okay. Let me try to answer. I'm not sure if I'm fully getting the question, but let me try to address that. So here, we are not talking about any mythological or any concept that you have to believe in somebody and believe in some concept and rely on something. So here, what we are saying is it is a completely scientific phenomenon. It's a pure science. It is applicable. Anybody can understand this concept and anybody can, benefit from this. That's what we are trying to say. In our concept, it is purely scientific and logical. You can logically experiment this whole concept and get the understanding and benefit from it and be psychologically free. So here in this case, at least we don't need any beliefs or any, there is no question of any myths or any kind of secret beliefs required or that sort of things required here. So maybe it is not applicable in this case.
Okay, thanks.
If somebody wants to ask the question, please use the hands raised option. There is a question which has come in chat. Okay. Venkateshan from Nigeria. He wants to talk to us on this occasion. I am giving an unmute. Yeah, you can talk to him. Venkateshan, you can talk to him now.
Yeah, good morning, Aya.
Hi, Venkateshan.
Yeah, good morning.
Yeah, hi, good morning, proceed.
Okay. I would like to get a clarification on this aspect. See, what happened, when the moment we wake up from the morning till night, we have interaction, actually. We are handling the things, we are going out to the nature, and we are handling with the, we are interacting with the human beings. Now, what is my question is, when we observe, we do with all the interaction with the like and dislike. But this like and dislikes, actually it comes from our nature. Actually, if I see one person I like him, another person is I don't like him. So when I that pop up from my nature, I feel that my interaction is not authentic. So how to be a real authentic relationship with everything? For example, if you look at the things, we are handling the things. The things are not going to affect me psychologically. Because if the things spoiled, so I get affected psychologically because I attach to that. So my point is that attachment. No, we attach to so many things and we attach with the nature, we attach with human beings, fellow beings. Now my question is, I would like to understand and I would like to clarify, get clarification from you. So we would like to have an authentic relationship, because authentic means I feel that our interactions are only related to mind level. I feel like that. But is there anything beyond that? That beyond means we are all living beings. I feel like that. We are all living human beings. So in that aspect, we need to have a good relationship, authentic relationship with other fellow being, in spite of like and dislike. How could be that? Because I feel that is the one is a good kind of. That means I feel that there has to be a real love or care. So I feel like this. So I would like to get your understanding from aspect of this one, sir.
Okay, thanks. So again, I think, two things I take it from here. One is the attachment, which you said, and then the genuine relationship with love and care is what you're talking about. Okay, first of all, to the attachment. So attachment is a problem only in the psychological system, like attachment to my emotions and feelings. Like I should be happy. I'm feeling worried if I'm not happy, or I should be peaceful, calm, silent, serene. So all those things, attachment to these emotions, either we by liking them or by disliking them, is the problem here. Attachment to your worldly things or to people or things is not a problem. Because once you understand the psychological system, then attachment to worldly events and activities is not at all a problem. So that is required to engage in any activities or in any relationship, right? So that is not a problem at all. So once we, only when we know this psychological system, then you will be able to handle that in a better way. Okay, second is about, you said about genuine relationship, love, care, etc. So again, in my view, I think some of this is more of, you know, dumped into us. You know, we've just got into our head. It has just got into our head that, you know, it should be real love or it should be genuine care or whatever it is. So if you do things without, by ignoring your likes and dislikes and what is required for that situation selflessly, because obviously if you ignore your likes and dislikes, then you will obviously do what is required for the situation selfless, regarding whether even if you dislike or even if you like something else, you will still do what is required to the other person, right? You will think about what is the other person require now. So that is actually genuine care and love, as you said, you know, as I will suggest that. So not about your imaginary things, you know, you may be having some imaginary concept about genuine care and love, whereas ignoring our likes and dislikes and doing what is necessary to the other person is what is genuine care and love. That's how I will put it.
Okay. Yeah, I understand your clarification. The other thing is that we are interacting with fellow beings. But what happened when we are in normal state, we are getting clarification, all the things. But when others are interacting, when they sort of group of people are four or five people, they discuss, suppose, criticize about the world, criticize about the people, what they are acting. They are acting as out of their nature. But when I am sitting there, but I also, something getting pop up in my mind that go on, tell them. Something is telling me in my head that go on, talk. Why they are talking like this? So go on, tell them that this is not the way of living life, all the things. Some guide is coming. I don't know whether this guide is authentic guide, or I don't know if it is from my mind, that is by nature. It is coming and telling me, go and tell them. Go and involve in that discussion and then tell them, you convey this one. So what kind of this thing, this is coming all sometime, not always. Sometime I feel that, okay, is coming out. I don't know from where it is coming. Let it be. Let them discuss. It is not our job. That also is coming. What kind of this thing? Two things are conflict is coming, sir.
Okay. First of all, I think the priority is, first of all, to understand this concept ourselves and be psychologically free. That should be the priority, rather than trying to set right others or correct others, should be the second priority, because this is the primary requirement, right? First, I need to understand, then I need to be psychologically free. Then I can try to help others and try to correct others. Okay, so that is the first thing. Second thing is, mind is like a madhouse, right? Or you can say it's like a child, either way, right? It will keep on throwing whatever thoughts, emotions, depending on the situation you are in, whatever situations you are facing, depending on that, it will keep throwing some emotions, feelings, thoughts, something or the other will keep coming up randomly also, right? You cannot put that in order. That is why we are saying that mind is not under your control, so you don't have any necessity to even correct that. That's why we are saying that you can completely ignore these thoughts and it will settle on its own. Like how if you take if you pour water in a bowl and if you keep your hand, it will start, there will be waves forming in circles, right? And how do we stop these waves forming around? Waves are like your thoughts, you know, thoughts coming, going up, coming down, thoughts coming up, subsiding. So it's like that. Similarly, waves keep forming in the water, in the bowl, right? So how do we get rid of these waves? What should we do to get rid of these waves?
We don't need to do anything, because by naturally it will go off.
Correct. So if you try to do something, it will only create more waves. It will only create more disturbance in the system. So similarly, mind is also such a thing that if you try to do something, if you try to act against your thoughts and emotions, if you start liking and disliking your emotions and thoughts, then you will only start fighting with it. You will be separated. You yourself will fight against your own self. So that is what is happening here all the time, every moment. So what is the solution here? nothing. You don't have to do anything. Simply ignore all these things and simply do what is required for the situation. Like you said, for that situation, if you think something is right, you know, if you feel that something has to be conveyed to them, obviously you can go and convey. So you don't have to worry about whether the thought comes here or not. So what is required for the situation, and if you have the duty, if you feel that something has to be done in the external world activities, then you can go and do that. You don't have to worry about what emotion or what thought comes inside. Irrespective of that, you can engage in your activities.
Okay. Thank you, Aya. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay.
Later
thank
I
you.
Will come.
Yeah. Come. Thank you very much, Venkatesan. I'm muting you. Sanjay ji wants to talk to you. Okay. You. Finish. No hurry. Feel it comfortable. Okay, I'm giving unmute to Sanjay. Yes, Sanjay, you can talk to him.
Okay, so I have another question related to what Anandaji just told. It is true that we do not have complete control over our mind, but we do have some control over our mind. It is not that there is entirely no control over our mind. And when we say that in the external world, we have to do everything as per whatever is appropriate, and we don't have to consider our likes and dislikes, because in any case, our psychological state, they are flowing. And they are transitory. So in any case, they take care of themselves. But the point is that in the external, I understand that even good feelings are transitory and bad feelings are also transitory. But then what is wrong if I can extend the good feelings for some more time? Like instead of doing what is appropriate, if I do something which I like, so maybe that good feeling will continue for some more time. Even if it is transitory, there is no harm in extending the good feeling and minimizing the bad feelings as much as possible.
Okay. Okay, yeah. Yeah, obviously, if it is possible scientifically, then why will we get into such a concept? Yes. If it is possible to extend, if it is possible to reject certain feelings and emotions, then you know that's the nicest thing to have. But unfortunately, that's not reality, right? What will happen? Suppose you know you're getting a promotion in your office, or you're getting salary increment in your office, right? So you'll be happy at that moment. So after some time, after a month or two, then you will be used to that salary or that level of work. After some time, again, you will be unhappy. You will again start looking for the next level or the next target. So that happiness you will not be able to retain. It is only short-lived. And the moment you start fighting with it, you will not even enjoy that happy moment fully, right? Because you will be kept on thinking rather than enjoying the happiness at this moment. You'll be busy in thinking, how do I retain? You know, will it go away suddenly? You'll be worried, you know, when will it go away? Will I miss this happiness? So all those things you'll be thinking about, right? So that's the nature. That's how mind works. So you'll not be able to retain. That's why we are saying, and similarly, happiness as such, you will not be able to retain. Similarly, the sorrow feelings also, you will not be able to push it away depending on your own likes and dislikes. If you try to fight with it, it'll remain with you. Similarly, if you try to retain happiness, it'll immediately disappear. It will try to, you know, subside. That's the nature. If it is possible, then obviously we will do that. But unfortunately, that's not reality. So that's why we are saying the solution is, instead of fighting with all these things, if you simply leave it undisturbed, if you just allow it to flow and subside on its own, things are getting corrected. Where is the problem? If there is a problem, then you need to find it. You need to try and find a solution. We are saying there is no problem at all, then why do we need to break our head and try to find a solution? It is getting subsided in the next fraction of moment. That sorrow which came is getting vanished. It's going to subside.
then you don't have to do anything. But if you start fighting with it, you will be with that sorrow feeling for another 1 hour or even 1 month, depending on the situation, criticality of the situation. So that's why we are saying, if you simply allow things naturally to happen inside, only in the psychological state of mind, if you allow things to settle down naturally by ignoring all your likes and dislikes, your hates and likes, etc., things will settle on its own. But only in the external activity, external world activity, you can plan and do some, you know, target some plans and achieve your targets. But whereas here, you don't have any target. There is nothing to do here. Simply accept the nature as is. That is what we are suggesting. Are you getting it, Sanjay?
One minute. Yes. I think he has got muted. I will unmute him to answer. Sanjay, you have got unmuted. Now, you are able to? Oh, not at. Unmute. Yes, Sanjay, you are able to. Yeah. You can speak.
Yeah, now I'm with you. The thing is that what you say, that we cannot retain the feeling, which is true, that you cannot retain the feeling. But you cannot retain the feeling permanently. But for some time, I think you do have some control. You may not be able to retain it permanently, but you may be able to extend it slightly. Even good feelings or even bad feelings, sorrow, etc., you may not be able to push them away permanently, but you may be able to push them temporarily. So the point is that why do we give up total control? I mean, I understand that it is not possible for us to retain good feelings permanently and not possible for us to push bad feelings permanently. But in search of permanency, why do we have to leave out our little control on just extending it a bit? That control we have.
Okay, yeah. So Babulal sir, can you open that slide? I think this is relevant to
his. Sure.
I'm sharing some slides. Okay.
You got it now?
Yes, you can put it in PPT mode.
Yeah, I will give the projection.
Yes.
Just
click the next button. Yeah. So here, let us just explain how our body functions, right? So these are various body parts, right? Various body parts. So all these things, if you see, all these things work on their own. We don't have to give any command or we don't have any control on their functions, right? It's something like an auto mode. It happens on its own, right? So the next slide, sir. Correct. Whereas body has two functions. The previous slide, which talks about the auto mode, wherein all the functions happen on their own. For example, suppose you are busy in some work. You will not say that I forgot how to breathe. Or I forgot the digestion, I forgot to digest my food. No, right? It will keep on doing, body will keep on doing its work. We don't have to interfere or we don't have to even suggest or tell the body to do some function. It will happen automatically. Whereas in the manual mode, things like, for example, running, jumping, doing your work at office, eating, going out, planning, walking, all of that is your manual function. So your body has two types of function, right? One is auto, second is manual. Similarly, in mind also, there are two types of function. Next slide, sir. Yeah. One is the thoughts and emotions which occur on their own. You are seeing something, we are speaking here, suddenly one word of what I spoke might have got carried to some other incident, right? Suppose, say, if I talk about love, suddenly you might remember some other love or some other incident related to that. So physically you are here, all these thoughts, you do not want to be disturbed. You always wanted to be here. You always wanted your thoughts to be related to the situation you are in, but it is not under your control. Some thoughts will, one word will connect you and take you somewhere else. It's like a chain reaction, right? So that's how thoughts and emotions come up on their own. This is the auto mode function. Even in mind, there is a second function, which is the manual function. Next slide, sir. Yeah. So this is the manual function wherein we also use our mind to think and plan our activities. Like even for example, for setting up this meeting, we have to think about the schedule, what time is possible, what is the duration, how do we do that? I have to set up this area, this, you know, room for this. So all these things I need to think and plan. I have to be think about what should I speak about today. So what are the, you know, questions that I can expect? So all those things, I have to think about that in mind, right? So mind also has two functions, manual and this one. So you can remove the, stop the slide, sir.
Yeah. Okay, fine.
So here, Sanjay, the point is, you're talking about two things. One is the thoughts and emotions which occur on their own. So here we don't have any role to play. Even if you try to do something, it is not going to listen to you. It will keep on happening on its own and it will subside also on its own. Only in the second portion wherein you have wherein it is manual, that is where you have a role to play, where you can plan and do your activities related to your external world as per your requirement and the situation you are in. So that is how it works. So in terms of you're talking about extending your happiness, or you know, you're talking about that. See, extend your happiness. First of all, yes, temporarily it could be possible, but what is the point you're trying to achieve by that? If it is required, if you are able to do that related to, if it is helping you in your external activities by doing that, yes, there is nothing harm in that. So what we are talking about is when you're not able to, when there is a problem, we are giving this as a solution. When there is a problem that you're not able to handle your mind, your psychological system, right? That's the whole problem that we're talking about, right? So we are not talking about retaining your happiness or your positive emotions on an interim basis. If that is possible, then yes, it is. There is no issue about that. But the problem is when you try to do that, you will only end up in sorrow, where we all are having so much of tension. We are onto so many problems every day because we are chasing this happiness. That's the whole, we are chasing our desire and chasing this happiness. That's the whole struggle we all have, right? That's how we ended up here and listening to all these teachings and various spiritual teachings. Why are we here? To set right this problem, to be peaceful. So it is again, search for that happiness is the problem. So that will only lead you to be continuously unhappy. That is what we are saying. The solution to this whole problem is, if you simply ignore that moment of uncertainty or moment of unsettlement or uncomfort that we feel in our system is going to just vanish in about a fraction of a second. You don't even have to bother about it, is what we are saying. Because whatever rises, it has to subside. Only because of you giving the energy to those waves or those emotions, it remains, it lives for whatever time, you know, for hours or months together, depending on the criticality of the situation. If you simply allow it to rest, it goes within the next moment, fractional moment, it subsides on its own. So that is what we are giving this as a solution for the whole problem that we face. Have you got it now?
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Sanjay. I am unmuting you. There is a question or clarification just come from chat. I'll project it.
Okay.
It says from your words. You're able to get it?
Yes, yes.
Good. I'll read it.
From
your words, I clearly understood that I am strengthening, keeping it alive, my conflict. By giving more attention to that, somehow wanting to resolve the conflict makes it perpetuate. And this person has given a comment. That comment is, Ananji, you are too good. Very good session. Okay, now I'll come back here now.
Okay.
you can answer the top portion.
I think it was not a question. I think it looks like a comment more. Yes, I think it was from Satyashri, I believe. Yes, I think you are very, it is very correct. We are only by fighting against it and by trying to sustain it, we are actually strengthening it. Suppose a negative emotion, by fighting against a negative emotion, we are only sustaining it. We are only helping to sustain it. We are giving life to it. If you simply allow it, it is going to subside in the next, very next moment. But because of you fighting against it, you are stretching that for hours or months together. Yes, very true.
One more, it follows. You got it?
Not yet.
Now?
Yes.
Okay. Aya, who is there in the present now, he's on the video. He has not given his name, but his mobile number accounts. He has given a comment like this. I think Aya's finding should also be supported metaphysically, don't you? Science goes on creating problems one after another, rarely solve things. There comes the metaphysics to our help.
Okay,
I'll come back.
Yeah, I mean, I don't exactly understand what is your point here, but yes, if it is helping in our external activities in creating a better world, if we can take help of metaphysics, obviously we should welcome that with both our hands, no doubt about it. But what we are talking about here is about the psychological freedom, because only, see, for example, maybe I can just, it may help others who are new joiners today. So where is the problem actually? Why do we want psychological freedom actually? Because we all have so many sufferings in our life, right? So say, for example, a problem in your office or some relationship problems at your home or some sort of problems. Everybody has so many problems, right? Just take some example. So two people don't handle a problem in the same manner, right? Two people handle it differently. One person may be totally shattered. He may be feeling totally devastated, maybe feeling that, you know, my life is gone, lost. Another person may think of it as a temporary setback. That's all, you know, I can always think about other option. If I fail in this project, I can think about the next step. I can think and succeed in the next step or work on the next step, right? That's how two people can view the same situation in a two different manner, right? So where is the problem here? The physical situation is the same, whereas how do you take it in your mind? How is your mindset? How do you handle this psychologically is where it makes the difference. So that is why we are addressing the psychological system here, not the physical activities. Physical activities, anybody can handle it. It's relatively easier to handle, because whether I get into a problem in my office or some work-related problem or some other X person or you get into a problem, everybody has to go through the same solution. And in fact, you can also take help from others, your seniors, your well-wishers, or your, you know, whoever, your supervisors, whoever your higher authorities, people who know better to handle that situation. You can always take help. Your external situation, somebody can help you on your behalf. They can also do some work. So that is the easier part to handle. But whereas psychologically, the emotions and thoughts that we are struggling with is the relatively, that is the problem. That is where we do not know how to handle, right? That is where we get stuck. We do not know how to proceed. So that is why the importance of psychological freedom. So we always carry all our emotions like a baggage on our back. We continuously carry throughout our life, right? So by understanding this whole psychological system and by understanding this concept, we'll be able to drop our psychological baggage and we can walk freely. So that is what we are talking about. So if it helps in setting right our external world activities, then anything is welcome, whether metaphysics or whatever, physics, chemistry, anything is welcome. But what we are talking about is first psychological freedom. But because first you have to be correct, you have to be peaceful, be in a stable situation to handle your external situation in a better way, right? So we are talking about that here. Then once you are clear and once you are cool inside, once your psychological system is set right, then you can handle your external activities in whichever way you are comfortable. There is no end to that, right?
Thank you very much, Chair. Venkatesh in Nigeria wants to talk to us. Unmute. Please, you can talk, Mr. Venkatesh.
Hello.
Yeah, we are able to hear. Carry on.
When we are discussing some question pop up in my mind, so related to metaphysical. Actually, what happened when we see children, sir, there are two aspects is there. Internally, the psychologically, they are completely free. When I observed, it is just a memory. It's a past memory incident that happened to children, sir. Our children. When we see that psychologically, they are completely free. They leave it to the free flow. But when we see that the activity of the children, there is something behind them because it's like a guide. I feel like that. I feel now that when the child is a creative, you know, the creative activity, when we see the child, they do something, they want to do something physically. When we look at it very carefully, I feel that there something is behind them to do creative activity in the physical world. So, but when we, as we grow intellectually, that creative, is it suppressed? I feel like that there is something also, guide will be there for us to leave this physical world, do good things in the physical world with a guide or with a creative intelligence. Like a universe is running with a creative intelligence. Without creative intelligence, there is no activity in the universe, cosmos. Like that, is it not possible for us to get same guide from the creative intelligence to live a good life? Like we are saying about peace of mind and good health. These all things, can it not be possible to get the guide? Because if we, for example, as a practical reality, let me tell one thing. Suppose one person has the issue, health issue. But you know what generally we do? I was having health issues. I look at the internet and go to the so many people to get what kind of medicine is suitable for this disease to cure. But when we look at it very carefully, as you said, auto mode and manual mode of our body, auto mode is beautifully functioning. When we realize that auto mode is beautifully functioning, there is no control over in auto mode in our body. So what I feel that when our intellect is gone down, that means there is no hope, because we try to get medicines from all over the people and get advice. But you know, the medicine may be available in front of my room, in front of my house. If I took that, maybe my body illness will be healed. So this intuitive power or a guide, do we not have it? Do we not get touch with that? Why we are not able to touch with that? That is the question. For long I was getting it. So I was thinking to put it in English, but I was not asking in Tamil. So as I get opportunity to talk to you in English, so I put it in English. So can we get clarification on this? It will be helpful for universally everybody, every fellow being.
Okay, thanks. So you talked about children. So children, so why are they very creative and very energetic, is bubbling with energy, is because two things. One is they are completely free inside, as you mentioned, yes. Second is all those conditions by means of knowledge or whatever, which we get from the society or from your family or from your surroundings, all those conditioning, they're not yet conditioned, right? They are still remaining, they're still a child. So only when they start growing up, they will get all those conditions, likes and dislikes form in their mind. So that is the problem, because so a child will not think about, that I should not be worried or I should be happy always. So these kind of questions the child will not have. The child will simply merge with the situation. You know, if there is an activity, if they are playing something, they'll just enjoy the play. If they are doing some other work, so they will just get into that. So they will just do whatever is required, right? Simply they will do whatever is they like and whatever they don't dislike. So accordingly, they will just work on the situation. So they don't have any conditions yet in their mind. But the problem is when we start growing, as we grow older and older, so all those conditions from the society starts getting into us. So this is actually blocking our cycle. One is the psychological freedom and also the creativity which we talked about. So creativity means what? So all those thoughts, emotions, which I said, right, in auto mode, it comes on its own. So you maybe if you start thinking about something, suddenly you may get some thought or some idea about something. So if you allow that to flow freely, and whatever is required to be applied for your external actions, you can always take it from there. So how this psychological freedom helps is you will be able to view it in a neutral way without your likes and dislikes. As I said, you know, whatever is required for the situation. See, creative means, again, you don't have to force yourself to do some creation. Right? Because if there is a creation, if you feel something creative inside, automatically it will come out and you can try to execute that in the real life situation, if the situation permits. So the situation is more important. And according to the situation, we have to act, right? Not just because of you getting some creative idea, you cannot implement unless the situation permits there. So I will say that all these creative help and all that is definitely possible. Once you are psychologically free inside, then you will be able to freely act based on the intuitions or whatever you get.
Yeah, thank you for the clarification. The other question is, I forgot, actually it was coming. When it comes up, I will come back.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you, Venkatesh. Anybody is having a question? Kindly rise. Hands rise option, please. Your time is up now. We started at 11. Now it is just short to 12. Yeah, great. Sanjay ji, I am unmuting you. Come on, unmute. Yes, Sanjay ji.
I was just listening to what about the how child functions. So that is all right, that child is psychologically free. But child, he doesn't act like what we are saying, that in the external world you have to act whatever is appropriate. But in the external world, child is not acting acting about what is appropriate. The child is acting what he likes. Even though psychologically he is free, still in the external world, he is not guided by appropriateness. He is guided by whatever he likes. So why don't we also do the same, that psychologically we don't give any importance in the external whatever we like.
Okay. So yes, correct. You're right. Child does only whatever the child likes. Only psychologically they're innocent. They don't have any knowledge yet to the appropriateness of the situation, right? For example, if they don't know a fire will hurt, they will just go and put their hand inside. But we have that knowledge, so you will not do that. You will only do whatever is appropriate for the situation. Or for example, another example, if you take, suppose my boss comes and yells, shouts at me. I want to give a slap to my boss. I feel like giving a slap. Will I give? I will not, right? Because I know the appropriateness of the situation. If I do something, then it will result in some disadvantages, some bad effects for me, right? At workplace, at office. So I know the appropriateness of the situation. I will not behave which is not in line with the situation I'm in. So if you want to, so you are saying, why should I behave appropriate? Why not I behave the way I like?
Yeah. I should then why should I not act selfishly?
Yeah. So in fact, we are acting selfishly only most of the time, and so that is not a problem at all. In your external life, you can act selfishly also, as long as you have to face the consequences. As I said, you know, your boss is shouting at you. So what is your like? I mean, what is your instant reaction? Is you want to shout at him or give a slap to him? That will be your instant natural reaction. But you will immediately think, if I do that, what will happen? Right? You will think about the consequences, about the repercussions of that. So you will obviously try to tone down or put it politely. So that is what is appropriateness of the situation. Not just doing whatever you immediately busted, you know, what came up immediately, like firing, again shouting back at him, but thinking about it, of the consequences, and then handling the situation in an appropriate way. So that will actually, otherwise you will only feel uncomfortable, right? You will not be able to handle your situation.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir, we
hello.
Can hear you.
Hello. Hello. Okay. Can you hear? Okay. So when we talk of consequences, then we are going on to a slippery slope, because it kind of then implies that if there are no consequences, then I should keep on doing selfishly. If there are no consequences, then I should keep on cutting corners. There is no harm in that. Okay. Because a lot of times, suppose I'm a merchant, and if there are no consequences of my avoiding tax, then I should not pay. Because from my selfish point of view, I do not want to pay taxes. And what you are saying, that there may be consequences, but if there are, suppose, no consequences, then in that case, should I continue with that selfishness?
Okay. So, do you believe in karma? Karma theory?
See, I actually, I'm not really sure what I believe in. I have done a lot of spiritual shopping, and I think I'm totally confused what I believe in or what I don't believe.
Okay. So there are two approaches. So one I will say is, if you believe in karma and if you go by that, then obviously even if you try to do something, even if there are no consequences, so it will obviously come back, right? If you do something bad, because the society that we are living in is like a society, we have created the rules. We have set up all these rules and regulations for our own comfort. All of us, you, me, and all these people together have created this situation, created this society and the rules and regulations, right? So it is not correct for me to go beyond to misjudge those rules, right? So otherwise, so that is one approach, because we have only created for our own comfort. If you're doing that, then obviously you will have consequences. That is one. Second thing is karma, which we mentioned. So whatever bad karma you do, it will somehow come back, is the belief, if you believe in karma. The third point is, you said if there are no consequences, whether I can go ahead and do something which is not correct, then if you are ready to face the consequences, suppose you said about tax evasion and things like that. Yes, there are so many people doing that, and some people get caught. So if you're ready to face the repercussions and face the legal issues, yeah, then you have to be ready for that. That's all. Nobody can stop you. So in the external world, even if I tell you that, you should do this and not this, then nobody is going to follow that, right? They are only going to do whatever is appropriate for them, whatever they feel like doing. So if you do, then you have to be ready for the consequences. That's all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Sanjay ji. Anybody else who wants to ask the question, raise your hand. Option, please. Okay, there are no questions now. We have completed the program time. Anandji, you want to have, you can go ahead for closing? Or you want to have some talk to the people?
No, I think so. That's what I wanted to explain. So, those slides which I wanted to take everyone to, which we already did. So I will insist on that psychological freedom which we talked about. So, maybe if you want to open, unmute all of them, and if they have any specific comments or something.
Yeah, I'll do some little formalities, then we will go to all these people.
Sure.
Okay. So, on behalf of all the people, I thank Anandji for this great service that they have done to our group. Thank you so much, Anandji. So I am stopping the record, then we will get into the questions.